at least the way he recounted it to me, had sort of resigned himself to the fact in many ways that, hey, look, probably not going to be producing the next Van Halen record. If Ed and Don want to do it by themselves, it's for the best, because it had gotten difficult. And Ted had come to the realization that Ed Van Halen had grown to a place where he wanted to have more control over his own music. I mean, I think Ted was resigned to that fact. What Ted didn't want was the band to break up.
Right.
And that's where I think Ted had went to pains in the book to explain to me, and really wants everyone to know, that despite what people might think, that Ted went with Dave, all this other stuff, that Ted never wanted the band to break up.
Right.
Ted tried, you know, in the ways that he could, presumably because he was communicating more with Dave, to try to convince Dave, don't leave, work it out, don't leave, work it out. And,
right.
and to try to work on that. And that did not happen. And then to continue on that point with you guys, I want to make sure that one of the things that Ted really emphasized in the book too, that Ted never thought it was going to be a long-term split. Like, he just thought these guys need time apart, you know, in the same way. I don't know if Ted would have phrased it this way, but I think an analogy we'd all understand is like Aerosmith in the early 80s. Perry and Tyler go their separate ways for a couple of albums. There's this 3 or 4 year period where there's this cooling off, and suddenly those guys kind of realize, well, we can't live without each other record, hence Done with Mirrors.
Right.
It never ended up happening. You know, there's a lot more in the book about all that, but, you know, it was never, and Ted was really adamant about this, it was never a matter of he chose Dave over Ed. And in fact, Ted emphasized as well in the book that he never wanted to do the movie.
Right.
You know, he didn't want Dave to do the movie. He
right.
thought it was a stupid idea and thought it was just, you know, why not just make records? It's just, this is crazy to do
right.
this. But, you know, things went the way they went. Yeah, I just wanted to kind of jump in there to make sure that's, because I don't think that's something that should be overlooked.
That's understandable.
But let me put it to you. But, Greg, actually, your point is well taken.
Yeah.
Because Ted loved the band so much, he didn't want them to break up, because to him, it wasn't Van Halen without Dave.
Correct.
That's a big change from the beginning, when Ted's like, I'm in love with the guitarist. The rhythm section is decent. The lead singer, I don't know. But cut to the chase, like 6-7 years later, and it's not a band without Dave. So what turned Ted's opinion around of Dave during that time?
Well, I mean, what turned it around was even before, so in between the demo. The demo, Ted signs the band in February, and Ted sees them at the Starwood in February 1977, and they basically finalized the record deal within a month of that. Soon after that, around April or something like April or May, they go into Sunset Sound and they do the demo. And when Ted heard and watched Dave record the Warner Brothers demo, it's on, you know, from, we've all heard the tracks on YouTube, the 25-song demo, Ted became concerned, because especially under the Microsoft of the studio, rather than a live situation, a lot of Dave's limitations as a traditional vocalist kind of came to the fore in Ted's mind. And he was concerned, you know, and part of this was, Ted would tell you that Dave, I'm not sure we detailed it in the book, but, you know, that Dave maybe had not written vocal melodies that he could really pull off. That he was not, you know, like a lot of people, maybe not fully engaged with what he did super well and what he didn't do as well as he could do, and then things where he shouldn't just try to do certain things that he wasn't capable of pulling off. So that's where Ted got concerned. He's like, this could be a real problem. So in the weeks that followed, though, Ted, again, mulled over this idea of bringing Sammy Hagar into the band. You know, he didn't tell Sammy at the time, and the person he probably told, or he did tell at the time, was Don Landy. He mentioned to Don
right.
about this, sort of this idea that, you know, maybe I could do this. But Ted went into the basement with those guys and started working on the record, the pre-production for the record, listening to the songs, trying to think about how to improve arrangements, fix vocal harmonies, whatever the producer would do to tweak a band's catalog in preparation for their first record. You know, in doing that, that's when Ted said he really got to talk to Dave on a very, very deep level, understood how smart the guy was, how great his lyrics were, and just really that said that Dave had a certain, that sort of that it factor as a, with the charisma, the sense of humor, the intelligence, the charm, all the things that Ted could see were really, you know, things that were big pluses for him, understanding that his singing may not always be to Ted's liking. And so Ted said, hell, I'm going to make this work. We're going to figure out how to make this work. And Ted said it was, at times it was challenging with Dave to get things right, but it was, you know, Ted's 180-degree turn to be like, you know what, I'm going to go forward. This is, we're going to make it work, from going, I don't know if this will work. That happened before they recorded the record. So in that period of just working with those guys in the basement, the legendary Roth basement in Pasadena,
right,
hour after hour, looking at the chalkboard with all the song titles, thinking about which ones they were going to record, and just really trying to get the material fully prepared for that, recording that first album.
But the weird thing is, Greg, is that Dave is Dave is Dave. He's always been Dave. He's always been smart. He's always been funny. He's always been charismatic. He's sort of that guy now. He was that guy in the 90s. He was that guy in the 80s. He was that guy in the 70s. Sure. So, like, what I didn't understand is, why didn't he see that from the beginning? Because, you know, obviously, Roth was a kid. I mean, obviously, he needed some honing up and cleaning, which a producer of his caliber could do. And he's raw. I mean, he's coming in off the street. But much like Ozzy Osbourne or Mick Jagger or Vince Neil, Dave's a vocal rock stylist. None of those guys that I mentioned are Freddie Mercury. You know what I mean? No one has a gorgeous, incredible voice. Does Sammy have a beautiful... Yeah, Sammy's amazing. Sammy is unbelievable vocally. But there are certain things that Sammy doesn't have that Dave has, as we all know. Mm-hmm. But obviously there was a chemistry between Ed and Dave, which is palpable even before Ted came onto the scene. You could hear it in the bootlegs. How is it that someone of Ted's caliber could not recognize that magic just from the two of them?
Well, I don't think he thought about it as the magic of the two of them. I think he thought about that I have this incredible guitar player, this guy who's the best musician I've ever seen perform in a live context, and I have a singer who I don't think is his equal, but even close. You know, I'm not saying that to run down Dave. I'm just saying that's where Ted was concerned, that if you get a guy in the studio who can't pull it off, it's a problem. It's
right.
A big problem.
Okay.
You know, and so I think the other thing to understand is that when you guys are mentioning the sort of the brilliance of Dave and stuff like that, I mean, they really didn't spend a lot of time in the same room kind of locked in until they went into the basement.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's sort of like, you know, you come in the studio, it was a 2-day thing. It was
right.
Basically, they recorded all the songs in one day,
right.
They cut the vocals the next day, and then they got to listen back. And when I listened to the demos with him, or, you know, from YouTube, we listened to them, and it was just like, he'd be like, oh, that, you know, that's pretty good. Like the screams, like he talked about the amazing screams that Dave did on Voodoo Queen. You know, he's like, you know, it wasn't like he was like, this all sucks.
Right.
He never was like that at all. He was like, this is good, but this is like, this was a problem. This is not, you know, and again, understand that Ted wasn't coaching Dave at that point. It was
right.
Just like, let's just go through the songs. They just
right.
Basically cut the songs live. And so he was like, shit, what if this guy can't, what if I can't coach this guy?
Right.
What
right.
if I can't, you know, what if he's going to be in there and it's like, okay, you know, we're trying to make this record and this guy literally can't do any better. So I think in working with Dave in the basement and talking to him and kind of spending time in close quarters and saying, this guy's, for lack of a better term, coachable. He wants to get better. He's going to get better. And that's where the confidence kind of came from spending the time in the basement with him, getting ready to record in that summertime leading up to recording the record, where he was with him, you know, he would say that we spent hours and hours and hours and hours in that basement. They all lived in Pasadena, which is the other kind of
right.
Old Michael may have lived in Arcadia, but they all lived
right.
Within like 10 minutes of each other. So he said, I was over there all the time. You know, I would come home from Sunset Sound after doing Doobie Brothers record, and those guys would be rehearsing late at night. I'd go over there and I would stay there with them and listen to the songs and say, yeah, let's change this around. Let's rework this, or this is great. These are the three songs for sure we're going to do. And, you know, I think that was the thing, was just getting to know Roth better on more of a one-on-one level, you know, kind of
right.
Where you would have long in-depth conversations rather than just sort of like talking to someone on the phone or, you know, in passing. And then that those time in the studio when you're not like bullshitting with him, you know, you're just basically like, okay, next song, let's go. Cause you're trying to knock the demo out.
And in terms of working with Ted on this book, did you ever ask him about what's in the archives or if there's any live recordings or extra tracks left over in the Van Halen catalog?
You know, he's not somebody who's been in the Warner Brothers archives in you know, a really long time. And I never really even asked him that other than the fact that I maybe asked him about, I did ask him about why they never did a live album. He was like, I don't remember. I don't think we even talked about it in the book because he couldn't remember if it was ever a serious thing.
Yeah.
He didn't think it was, but you know, it's one of these things that maybe they did talk about doing a live album with Ted and that it was just sort of pushed to the side, you know, but you know, he was never somebody who was going to be looking back on the stuff. It wasn't his, like, there was never any quote unquote, like catalog work that Ted did, right? It was just basically the six albums and then those guys went on with their career and it wasn't as if Ted was involved with what they did.
One thing that was a little confusing, I'm trying to understand in the book. I understand what you're saying that in 1984, Ed is growing. He's got his own studio. He wants to do his own thing. He wants to produce himself. Made sense. But what I didn't understand is why the band sent Sammy to Ted to beg him to produce 5150.
Well, here's what ended up happening was that Ed and Don wanted to produce, well, I should say Ed wanted he and Don to produce what became 5150.
Right.
What ended up happening is that the president of Warner Brothers, Lenny Waronker, says to those guys, no, you're not going to produce the record by yourself. Basically, for whatever reason, Ed Van Halen never produced an album before. Don Landy had always been an engineer, didn't want those guys to produce it by themselves. They needed to have a producer. So what ended up becoming the obvious choice, probably partially encouraged by Lenny Waronker, the president of Warner Brothers, but also certainly if you think about it, Don, Sam, Ed, Mike, Al had all worked with Ted before.
Right.
Well, the record company, obviously they're going to accept Ted Templeman as the producer.
Right.
And so that's why Ted was approached with the idea of produce this seventh Van Halen album.
Right.
With Sammy Hagar as the vocalist. That's why, because they had to get somebody, because
right.
the record company said, Ed Van Halen, Don Landy, we're not giving the green light to you guys to produce the record by yourself.
So now the weird thing is, though, is you think from Ted, who is not only a producer, but also an executive at Warner Brothers, wouldn't you kind of feel company pressure to handle it? Because number one, Van Halen was a very high level commodity for Warner Brothers at the time. This is a transitional time, the record right after their biggest album and a new singer. Wouldn't you feel pressure as an executive and the producer in Warner Brothers to take the job on? Like, I would imagine that it would be very hard to say no, not only just to Ed, but to your boss at Warner Brothers, say, yeah, I'm not going to do it. Isn't that sort of like hard to do? I mean, in the sense that wouldn't he feel pressure to come through for his company?
Well, I'm sure he did feel pressure to come through. You know, he never really couched it that way. I mean, it was the way it's laid out in the book is he at first said he didn't want to do it and then basically relented and said, I'll do it if you guys change the name.
Right.
And those guys would not, you know, and again, I think understandably, I think that Ted regrets that it was, he couched it that way because he didn't mean to disrespect the Van Halen brothers by saying that. He just felt like it was a different band, not that he wasn't honoring their name as Van Halen. So he didn't mean any disrespect to the brothers in that way. But I think ultimately it was just, it was something he felt very passionate about and probably had enough juices inside Warner Brothers to be like, I'm not doing it unless they do this. And if you think about it, it's Van Halen. It wasn't as if Warner Brothers was going to be like, oh shit, if Ted Templeman doesn't do it, no one's going to do it. You know,
right.
Like,
no, right.
Guys
right.
would have like freaking like crawled over broken glass.
Right.
Through
right.
minefields to produce the record.
Right.
You know, but it was a definitely, you know, I think that in reading the book, people understand it was definitely an emotional issue for all those guys and the way it sort of, it shook out. There were things that went on with Dave's solo EP that Ted had certain expectations about what he thought he was doing
right.
with that and what he, how he thought it was going to be helpful. And it ended up being a very corrosive thing for Van Halen. And that was never his intention. Again, he never wanted the band to split up and was just trying to do what he thought was best for what, where things were at with the band. And so I think that was just basically, you know, he was going to say, look, this is how I feel about it. I don't want to do it. But, you know, I think the other thing too, I don't think it's in there because it was just Ted didn't remember it specifically. But if you read some interviews, anyone reads interviews with, did with Guitar World around 1986 or so. I mean, Ted went up to 5150 and heard the music and everything at some point before he said no or whatever. You know, he was obviously was toying it over in his mind to some extent to doing it, but ultimately maybe he just felt like he couldn't come to peace with it called being Van Halen with Sammy in the band. I mean, that was just something he felt intensely about for whatever reason, that this was something he just couldn't accept it. I mean, I think that was for whatever reason, just thinking this was the band I signed was Dave and Ed together, Mike and Al. It's
right.
not with another singer. No offense to Sammy. And, you know, I think Ted really tried to go to great pains in the book to make that clear that he loves Sammy the person. He loved working with Sammy.
Right.
Sammy's a friend of his. That
right.
That it's nothing personal against Sammy. Like, you know, you could have brought in, we didn't write this book, but you could have brought in Jesus Christ to be the lead singer of Van Halen.
Right.
It could have been Van Halen to Ted. I mean,
right.
That's,
well, that was clear. That was
Sammy.
Clear. Yeah, that was clear. One thing that was also interesting was the whole Crazy from the Heat thing is so shocking to me. Like, how did Ted not think that that wasn't going to cause a major riff between a band that was not exactly on great footing as it is?
You know, he'd have to speak for himself on that. I mean, I think that from what he told me, he saw it that it's something that was going to give breathing room to people. you know, years have gone by. Maybe some of that is Ted sort of like, you know, as memory sort of has faded a little bit, maybe Ted has sort of lost sort of the, you know, remembering how intensely some of the emotions were about things like that with Dave and Ed back then. But I